Thank you. please have a seat. You did it! Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, students, families, friends, and colleagues. My extraordinary privilege, each and every one of you, on behalf of the Board of Trustees, our faculty, staff, our foundation, and the alumni, to the 52nd commencement of Greenfield Community College, the graduation of the great class of 2015. By the way, this is a party. Feel free to let it rip. So I want to introduce to you our platform party from your left. Today, on your left is Professor Brian Adams, Yacoubian Award winner Tim Shippey, Representative Paul Mark, Student Trustee Chad Wright, Board of Trustees Chairman Robbie Cohn, Student Speaker Guinevere Van Horn, Chief Academic and Student Affairs Officer Cher Ruska, Dean Mary Ellen Feidenkevich, Professor Dean Kathy Brainos, Professor Kate Finnegan, Yacoubian Award winner Junie Green Corvey, and our registrar Holly Fitzpatrick. I would also like to introduce our GCC Board President Robin Provost, Board Members Kathy Cole, Lee Ray, Pat Coffin, Trustees Amy Hollick Moscatello, Claire Higgins, and from the Department of Higher Education, Associate Commissioner David Cedrone. So welcome everybody. Honored students, you have learned a great deal here at GCC. You have studied math, science, and the English language. You can now communicate more effectively, think more critically, and you can solve problems more creatively. You have learned about other people, other cultures, and you have learned more about yourself. Most of all, dear graduates, you have learned how to learn. Your achievements are a reflection of your hard work, and they are also a reflection of the many who have supported you. It would be impossible to imagine today's celebration without recognizing the people who helped you get here. The truth is that you would not be graduating today were it not for your moms and dads, aunts, uncles and cousins, grandmas and granddads, sons and daughters, husbands, wives, partners, friends, and all of the other significant people in your lives. They were sometimes seen and sometimes not. They were sometimes silent and sometimes not. They were sometimes sympathetic and sometimes not so much. But they were always there for you because of their love for you. So let's take this moment to stand and by your applause, shouts, and hollers, let them know just how much you appreciate all of them. Your achievements and your learning are also a reflection of the passionate commitment of the faculty and staff of GCC. Each have come to GCC because of you. This college's faculty and staff love teaching, learning, and students just a tad more than their subject. Although they are trained scientists, nurses, doctors, writers, and artists, they see themselves first as teachers. It was the faculty and staff of GCC who saw your potential sometimes before you did, and together you have worked to achieve it. So dear graduates, again, please stand and let your teachers know just how much you appreciate the hard work and their passion. In addition today to presentations by student Guinevere Van Horn and Professor Kate Finnegan, I also have the privilege of sharing just a few thoughts in honor of your achievement. F. Scott Fitzgerald wrote that the test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposed ideas in the mind at the same time and still retain the ability to function. I would like to share with you today two ideas that seem opposed, but are in fact two ideas that will pave a stronger path to a brighter future. While in graduate school at the University of Texas at Austin, we were privileged by a series of guest speakers who were leaders in community colleges and universities around the nation. One of those who spoke was Alfredo de los Santos, who was then the Vice Chancellor of Academic Affairs for the Maricopa Community College System in Maricopa County, Arizona. Dr. De Los Santos spoke of his role as the academic leader of the second largest community college system in the United States. What I remember most, more than his presentation about specific programs or pedagogy, were his reflections on his personal journey coming across the borders from Mexico to Texas, and then being the first in his family to attend college. He spoke of being a border crosser from Mexico and then again as a first-generation student. We were all in tears as Alfredo began to cry with pride and humility as he talked about what it meant to his parents, to his children, and to himself to be the first Mexican-American to earn a PhD from the Community College Leadership Program at the University of Texas. The classroom was filled with great respect for Dr. De Los Santos, as well as the transformative powers of the community college mission. It was customary to have lunch or dinner with the speaker, and so we could meet and greet more informally. One by one, we would move down the reception line before the meal. I shook Dr. De Los Santos' hand, and I said, "My name is Bob Pura, and I want to thank you for your presentation." "Pura," he said, looking at my name tag. I smiled, understanding his misunderstanding and misreading of my family heritage, and I said, "No, it's Pura." "Pura, Roberto Pura, be proud of who you are," said Alfredo. Again, I smiled, and now I could hear a few chuckles from my classmates. "I am proud of who I am," I said. "My dad was also an immigrant, but he was born in Poland, not Mexico." He looked at me for just a second, somewhat serious, and then he laughed, a really big laugh. He grabbed me and gave me a big old Texas bear hug, lifting me off the ground in appreciation of the moment. 3 years later, Gerardo de los Santos, Alfredo's son, also graduated from UT, and today he is the CEO of the League for Innovation in Community Colleges. Crossing all of those borders has a significant and profound impact on many generations. Each of you sitting here today understands the journey of a border crosser. You know what it is like to be the first to attend college in your family, or to make a midlife career change, or to earn the GED and then attend college. You are all entering a new land as you walk through the doors of GCC on the journey of your life. You get what Dr. De Los Santos was saying, right? Be proud of who you are. You don't have to be a Bryan Adams or a Teresa Jones to understand that the strongest of trees have the strongest of roots. You know that sometimes in life, the wind is at your back, the sky is blue, and all is good. You also know all too well that at other times, the winds will blow hard against you. Those with strong roots will prevail. Many studies of first-generation college graduates who go on to successful careers often develop feelings of doubt that somehow they don't belong in such successful ranks, or that they don't even deserve to pursue their dreams. In a case study of UMass faculty who were first-generation students, I remember reading about the professor who grew up in Boston, the son of Italian immigrants, and the first to attend college in his family. When his father asked him why he wanted to go to college, the son replied, "Because I want to be somebody." His dad paused, fell silent, and said, "Oh, so you think I'm a nobody?" Crossing borders is never easy. I have a photo of my dad on the wall of my office at home, right next to my diplomas. He's at work in the deli with a few salamis in his arms. He is smiling the smile of a very rich man. It is the smile of a man who found purpose, passion, and meaning in his life. Dad was an immigrant. He never graduated high school, and he worked all my life in a delicatessen. He had Wednesdays off, but there in that photo was the smile and the eyes of a rich man. That is what we want for each of you. From nursing to engineering, corporate leadership to small business entrepreneurship, English to education, or art making to accounting. We don't care what position or career path that you choose, only that you work to live the life you want for yourselves and the discovery of meaning, purpose, and some joy along the way. So on one hand, I urge you to invest in you. Never let your past harness your future. Don't hold yourself back from living the life of your dreams. But on the other hand, I challenge you to think beyond yourself. One of the many wonderful accomplishments of this great class is the development of the GCC Child Care Center. Because of your persistent and patient voice, and because of the commitment of our state legislative delegation, the GCC Child Care and Education Center has been funded, and the planning for its design and construction is underway. Let's take this moment to thank our legislators, Senator Rosenberg, Representative Kulik, and Representative Mark, and your elected student leaders, former Senate President Kia Burton, Foundation Board Member Tamara Grimard, and Trustee Chad White. So by the winter of 2018, the doors will open to an excellent building, providing an excellent start to a lifetime of learning. We all understand the significant impact that a strong start and a strong foundation will have for those children and their parents for the rest of their lives. Dear graduates, that's a wonderful accomplishment. You pushed, you pulled, you voiced the need, you showed up at all those meetings, and now it is funded. But your work is not done. We together as a community must now embrace each of those children who will graduate from our school as our children. Think about that for just a few minutes. What if everyone here today were to embrace each child in that child care center as our own? Think of the collective and transformative power of a community, a state, a nation, all on our planet, treating each child as our own. Harvard professor and author Robert Putnam's new book, Our Kids, The American Dream in Crisis, begins by describing his hometown of Port Clinton, Ohio. He says, "My hometown was in the 1950s the possible embodiment of the American dream." He goes on to describe a place where hardworking families would collectively promote opportunities for the betterment of all. He then writes, "It was a place that offered opportunity for all kids in town, whatever their background." Today, Putnam reports that Port Clinton is a split-screen American nightmare, a community in which kids from the wrong side of the tracks that bisect the town can barely imagine the future that awaits the kids from the right side of the tracks. Putnam argues that the American dream of social and economic mobility is in crisis because Americans used to care about other people's kids, and now they only care about their own kids. Graduates, Somewhere around 1980, less than four decades ago, we began to lose our way. We shifted from a we society to a me society. And the impact has cost us all a great deal. Well, 99% of us. We live in cynical times. We doubt that we can impact change and make things better. But that is just not the case. Ladies and gentlemen, we are not tied on tracks to that end like a runaway train. Our own history provides the hope for our future. And here is more good news. We live in a community that gets it. We live with the local bankers, the employers, the political leaders, embrace their responsibility, and are deeply engaged in creating opportunity for all. We live in a community that understands that the family living down the block without enough food is our family, and that the kids around the corner who need diapers, a backpack, a big sister, or a scholarship are our kids. We understand that the elderly who need meals delivered to their homes are our parents, and we certainly have learned from the opiate task force that the addicted are not those kids from those families, they are our kids from our family. But let us not fool ourselves. The economic and social forces of our country are crashing in on the ways of our community. Putnam closes our kids with a chapter called What Is to Be Done. In that chapter, the author writes that the absence of villains does not mean that no one is at fault. He goes on to say that social policies reflect collective decisions, and insofar as we all have responsibility for those collective decisions, we are implicated by our failure to address removable barriers for all. So in closing, here are three action steps that I culled from that chapter and suggest to each of you, under each of us under this tent today. Support, number one, support parental leave legislation and change fund and state-funded childcare and pre-K programs. Number two, show up, you can applaud for that, show up at town meetings and work to return sports, music, and advanced courses back into the regular budget. And number three, get engaged in the political process. Support elected leaders who are working to increase opportunity for all. And work to defeat those in Boston and especially in Washington who vote to protect the me while talking the talk about the needs of the we. Honored students, please keep in one hand the message that the pursuit of your dreams is a good thing. If you are not investing in you, then who will? And in the other hand, hold close to your heart the understanding that committing yourself to the well-being of others is also a good thing. To be passionate in your commitment to both, to the we in me and the me in we, is a beautiful thing. We all have met some very special people along the way. You can tell instantly that they are special. They are in our families, in our communities, where we work and where we play. They are men, women, they are young, and they are our elders. They all have this very special light that shines from within. That is the light that shines for others more than the self. That is the light that places we before me. That is the moral beacon on which we should all aspire. Dear graduates, rebalance the economic and social wheels of justice. Change the downward spiral of selfishness and greed into the widening gyre of hope and opportunity for all. Cross all of your borders to create a better life for yourselves, your families, and for all of our children. To the great class of 2015, congratulations to you all, and Godspeed. Thank you. Our next two speakers are the very embodiment of the themes of my message today. Crossing borders to achieve a better life is exactly the path that your student speaker, Guinevere Arthur Van Horn, has taken. Guinevere grew up in Jamaica and never imagined that she'd be able to go to college. She worked as a certified nursing assistant starting in 2010 when she graduated from the CNA certificate program here at the college. Her supervisors at work encouraged her to pursue her dream of college and then enroll at GCC. While working and raising her two young daughters, Guinevere excelled as a student at GCC. She served as president of our chapter of Phi Theta Kappa and was engaged with community service projects, including a fundraiser to support a family in need of a wheelchair accessible van, volunteering in a soup kitchen, raising money for the GCC food pantry, and working on a toy drive. Guinevere has also served as an orientation leader and a peer tutor. And she is graduating with a 3.94. Professor Jay Gump, Guinevere's mentor, said, "Guinevere's success at GCC is largely a result of her enthusiasm. She is certainly intelligent," he says, "but the energy Guinevere brings to school every day carries her beyond preconceived notions that limit the application of knowledge. Guinevere radiates curiosity, a profound appreciation for education. Her presence elevates the performance of her peers. Students like Guinevere carry the spirit of GCC into the community and ultimately represent the essence of our mission. Guinevere will travel to Smith College with a full scholarship to study biology and then continue." That really deserves applause. "And then she will continue on towards her master's degree. She plans a career as a physician assistant, and hopefully Guinevere in a rural Massachusetts area like where she lives in Roe. Her journey represents the courage, intelligence, and the heart found throughout the classrooms, offices, and studios of our college. Guinevere is a strong, smart, and compassionate woman who will create a brighter future for herself, her family, and her community. Honored students, please welcome your class speaker, Guinevere Arthur Van Horn."
President Piura, other distinguished guests, fellow graduates, families, friends, and well-wishers, a bright and beautiful day to you all. Today we are gathered to celebrate and to recognize the accomplishments of the hard work, determination, and resilience of our graduates. And I couldn't be more proud to be named among them. Like many occasions as this day will go by real quick. So let us take a moment to appreciate the depth of this experience. As I was researching commencement speeches, I came across a post from one of my friends. It was a photo of a card she had gotten from her husband for her graduation. It read, "Leave it to you to show the world what hard work and courage can accomplish. Leave it to you to lead the way in meeting every challenge, no matter how hard. Leave it to you to keep an eye on the goal until you've gotten to where you wanted to go." And I thought, exactly, I should borrow that for my speech. My friends, we have been on a tremendous journey. And today, it's about the joy, pride, and recognition of every waking moment that has gotten us this far. I haven't said it yet, but let me say it now. congratulations, and well done. As we reflect on our time spent within these walls, I would like to tell you a little bit of my story. And as I relate to you, my life's journey, I'd like for you to reflect on your own. Because even though my story is unique, it is not unlike many of the stories here today. As a little girl, I was raised by a most courageous, selfless, and resourceful single mother. We lived in the garrisons of Kingston, Jamaica. The harsh realities of my hometown resembled a scene from the movie City of God. Actually, the movie Shatta is an exact replica of how dangerous and violent the streets were for us. Yet, my mother raised four, and sometimes more, on what seemed little or nothing. We were well-fed and well-dressed. She always said that it's not because you live here that you are defined by here. She instilled in us a notion that better lies beyond the bullet-riddled fences, and the only way to get there was a great education. Thank you, Mama, for being our fortress. Yeah, Mama. And for guiding us through the unimaginable. When it came time for college, my mother's resources was not enough. And though it was heartbreaking, it was understandable that $3,000 Jamaican dollars a week, a mere 30 US dollars, is no match for the millions required for a four-year college education. When I arrived in this country, I wasn't headed to college. I was here for the white picket fence and the suburban life of a married woman. Yet that didn't happen. And through the horrors of an unhealthy relationship and my two daughters by my side, I recall the wisdom of my mother, that once there is life, there is hope. My hope was to get the education that I deserve and rescue myself and my daughters. Greenfield Community College gave me a second chance to make all that was wrong in my life right. Coming through these doors was more about breaking shackles, tearing down boundaries, and reclaiming my self-worth than anything else. When I struck gold here, I knew I was onto something. With the never-failing love of my mother and a few good Samaritans, college became my safe haven, the place where I would go to escape my reality and design a whole new one in due time. It has not been easy to carve out a future full of great prospects and promises. There has been sacrifices, late nights, withdrawals, tears, and broken down transportation. I continue to fight beyond these walls for my right to raise my daughters as my mom raised me, without fear and with the strength of lions. Yet through it all, I rise. And according to the Commonwealth, I shine, because I know that nothing worth more than gold is going to be handed to me on a silver platter. I know that hard work, determination, and resilience are the key ingredients to a life of immeasurable worth. And that, it never gets easy. You simply get better as you grow. As I look out in the audience, I see my beloved mother. I see beauty, grace, and pride, just as I had seen when I gave my first valedictorian speech in grade school, and again when I spoke at my graduation in high school. I see you now, Mama, and I pray that God will grant you the vitality of life so that the next time I stand on a platform, I will see your face in the crowd. Veo mis hijas bonitas. I see my beautiful daughters. Elliot and Juliet, I promise you that I will be that face for you in the crowd, just as my mom has been for me. Yo amo ustedes, mis hijas. I love you, my beautiful daughters. I see you, graduates. I see your pride, and I feel your joy. And I say to you, never forget. Never lose sight of where you're coming from, because that is how you will know where you are going. Today, as we celebrate this momentous occasion, I hope to inspire you to live out your dreams. I charge you, though, to do your part in helping others, like me and you, to write beautiful stories about their life journey. As future movers and shakers of this great nation, it is up to us to advocate, inspire, and motivate those around us. Let us show everyone who are curious and wanting to know that the impossible is possible. Like a phoenix, we can all rise from the ashes, stronger, bolder, and wiser. No matter where your journeys take you from here, remember the steps you took to your future. Remember, many yearn to make those same steps, and know that it is now our duty to ensure they can all make those same steps to their better tomorrows. Class of 2015, I salute you, and I wish you all the best in your future endeavors. Once again, congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you, Guinevere. Professor Kate Finnegan is the teacher's teacher. Kate's students include the very young, the not so young, as well as the more senior. Professor Finnegan's core and fundamental beliefs are that all students, no matter who or no matter where they are in life, have the right to a quality education, and that the quality of that education is improved when the voices of students are involved in its development. Kate believes that the privilege of teaching bears the responsibility of doing it well. For 35 years, Professor Kate Finnegan has driven about 2 hours each way every day to teach and to learn with you. Professor Finnegan has embraced every one of her students and every one of their students as her own, and she has treated every one of her colleagues as a member of her family every day of her career. For 35 years, Professor Finnegan has been a leader at GCC, not only because of her clear and strong voice, but by modeling the ways of excellence as well. A member of the GCC community said about Kate that she is the colleague everyone wishes they could have in their work. She asks the tough questions when others might shy away. She actively listens. She makes you laugh. She works fiercely for students. Kate is the real deal. I learned a lot from her. Just a few minutes ago, I said that we all have met some very special people along the way, that we know instantly when we meet them. They're in our families, and they're certainly here at our work. They are men, and they are certainly women in this tent today. And they are the young, and they are our elders. They all have a very special light that shines from within, and then I go on to say that it is that light that shines from within that is more about the others than the self. It is placing the we before the me. That is the moral beacon on which we should all aspire. Kate Finnegan is that beacon here at GCC. Students, colleagues, and guests, please welcome your faculty speaker, Professor Kate Finnegan.
Hello. Let me begin by just acknowledging, Guinevere, your beautifully articulate words is such a profound gift to all of us. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, hello and welcome to all. How did I get so lucky to be here with all of you in this moment of extraordinary celebration? Today I want to talk to you about two notions, and you may sense a reoccurring theme here. One, the importance of story, and two, the obligation of luck. First, let me too begin with a story from my college journey. True story. Once upon a time, I decided to go to college, and this decision made all the difference. But it wasn't an easy one. You see, I wasn't sure that I belonged in college. I was full of doubt. Was I smart enough to go to college? My high school transcript and a few of my elementary and secondary teachers would have suggested otherwise. But off I went. I remember being at a large university, larger than my hometown, sitting in a course with an intelligent and kind professor whose good opinion I desperately wanted. When he began to speak about the notion of disfluency, I froze. What was he talking about? I certainly had no idea. I looked around and it appeared that all the other students fully understood what he was talking about. I was overcome with emotion. Shame, whatever possessed me to think I belonged in college, and sadness. If I didn't belong in college, where did I belong, and how would I find my way? Then the endless loop of self-recrimination started up, including the voices of the Sisters of Mercy at St. Mary's Elementary School, the high school guidance counselor, who should have been advised into a different career path, and a few of my elementary and secondary teachers. And of course, my own voice was in the loop, reminding me of my failure to make honor roll list at every point in my schooling, my erratic SAT scores, and finally, the indictment of my high school superlative. No, I was not voted most likely to succeed. I was voted class clown. Let's hear it for a little humor. The rest of that class, I spent preparing my exit strategy from the course, the university, and the very idea of college itself. But to make a long story short, I didn't drop out. I persisted, I persevered, just like all of you sitting here today. And I applaud your persistence, The world needs you, educated and assuming positions of increasing authority and responsibility, to help all of us create meaningful and sustainable change for the greater good. Individually, each of you has made your way to this moment by steadfastly putting one foot in front of the other. And I, like Guinevere, ask you to pause and remember the discreet, incremental, sometimes almost imperceptible steps that brought you to this moment. Do not underestimate the importance of these early steps. Do not take them for granted. How did you make your way to GCC? How did you persist here? What were the most significant factors that were instrumental to your success? Your decision to enroll and to persist required courage and stamina, and each of you has a story to tell about your unique journey to this moment of celebration. So as you leave GCC, I ask you to pause and remember the steps you took and the decisions you made that culminated in this celebratory moment for several reasons. Revisiting your successes at GCC may be necessary in the future when you need to muster up the courage, the moxie, the pep, the know-how to tackle life's new challenges. Also, as you remember the details of your success here, you intentionally build and evolve the master narrative of your life. What you say to yourself about yourself really matters. Claim your narrative. Tell your story. In the words of E.E. Cummings, it takes courage to grow up and be who you really are. Social science research teaches us that inner talk is one of the most effective, albeit least utilized, tools to foster life success. Philosopher Susan Neiman wrote in her book titled Why Grow Up that the narrative demands real thinking for oneself, that telling your story fosters the ability to see life as the whole it has become and allows you to see the strengths with which you've lived it. Telling your story fosters the ability to develop a sense of your character, to figure out what sort of person you want to be, and then to resolve to work harder to become that person. Your complex subjectivity is uniquely yours. Honor it. Tell your story. Use your words to create increasing capability for self-understanding and self-advocacy as a way also to evolve your capability for curiosity about and care for others. Because as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. We are in this life together, and all our stories matter. I offer one important caution. Avoid the temptation to be what I call a peacock person. In The Road to Culture, David Brooks describes the 21st century trend towards a culture of display, of amplification of the selves. I urge all of us to avoid self-promotion. Instead, I ask all of us to investigate the myriad of reasons of why we as a species do what we do when we do it. Current student Kim Williams wrote about curiosity and care in her learning at GCC in this way. I am challenged to think further into ideas of grace, mercy, forgiveness, and luck. I have obtained a new perspective on others and about how the environment and other external factors contribute to who we are and how those factors might affect our lives. I've learned to stop and ask myself, under what circumstances might I do the same thing? Under what circumstances might I make a similar decision? Cultivate your capability for curiosity. Ask questions of both yourself and others. In doing so, Neiman asserted, you enlarge your mind, continually thinking from others' perspectives, stepping into as many pairs of shoes as you can find. By telling our stories, we remember, in the words of Professor Csikszentmihalyi from the University of Chicago, that our actions in this life are going to reverberate through time and shape the evolving future. Our stories help us figure out who we are and who we want to become. I first learned this lesson as a child, listening to my father's bedtime stories. My father was a prisoner of war during World War II for 2.5 years. And his remarkable, My father was a prisoner of war during World War II for 2.5 years, whose remarkable bedtime stories about being a prisoner were stories of hope, transcendence, humor, ingenuity, and resiliency. I was lucky to be the recipient of such extraordinary stories. The political philosopher John Rawls wrote extensively about the role luck plays in human affairs. GCC's presence in the Pioneer Valley is an example of what Rawls refers to as luck. We are lucky to be employees and students and friends of GCC. I marvel, still marvel, at the vision and strategy to locate a public community college here in Franklin County so long ago. And now I am awestruck by the vision and strategy involved in the future state-of-the-art building in which infants, toddlers, preschoolers, and their families will find sanctuary. We are lucky. With the realization of this luck, I believe there comes an obligation to be intentional and mindful about how we integrate this awareness of our luck into everyday practices, both here and elsewhere, both individually and collectively. You chose, students of the class of 2015, to come to GCC. Honor your membership in this community by advocating for its sustainability and by waking others up to its centrality in public higher education. We need the community colleges in public higher education. In other words, I ask you to tell your story. In conclusion, I want to underscore the importance of telling our stories so that we share how we achieved our successes, how we right ourselves after we stumble, and how we continue, in Naaman's words, to wrestle with the three questions that concern all of us. What should I know? What should I do? What should I hope? So let me close as I began. Once upon a time, I decided to go to college, and this decision made all the difference. Now, you tell your story, and then invite others to share their stories with you. Listen with care. Finally, continue to tell your story after you leave GCC, knowing that we are honored to be a part of your narrative. Be well, continue to flourish. Congratulations, we are so, so proud of you. Thank you.
Stories. Thank you, all of the speakers, for giving us memorable visions and feelings from today. We now move on to honoring some students, and I will call them by name and ask each of them as I call them to come forward. I do know, as the stories we've heard today suggest, that we are recognizing a small number of the victories that are represented in those of you who are sitting here today. So we do applaud all of you for the accomplishments that brought you here, even though we will be recognizing only a few by name at this point in the program. We'll call you all up one by one a bit later. So at commencement each year, we do recognize a set of students for particular awards, and I will go through these and we'll ask students to come up. We will recognize them. You can hoop and holler, scream as much as you like. We will enjoy it right along with you. And we look forward to your enthusiastic response too. So the first one that we give today is the Liberal Arts Award. Each year, the faculty and professional staff recognize the achievements of a student in the liberal arts. The recognition is based on several factors, among them the cumulative grade point average, the relatively demanding nature of his or her chosen course of study, and that most of the work has been completed here at GCC, along with the breadth and variety of involvement with the liberal arts. This year's award goes to Samuel Costello. Next, the Liberal Arts and Dance Award for excellence in dance and dedicated support of the GCC Dance Department. This award goes to Brittany Woodward. Award recognizes excellence in English. This year's award goes to two, April B. Albrecht and Alexandra G. Werbicki. Recognizes excellence in music. This year, the department selects Stephen Yonker. These are usually surprises, so if you feel like out there a little flutter in the tummy, it's because all of this is brand new. The Donald Oberacker Award goes to the graduate who has demonstrated outstanding academic achievement and commitment to the study of science. This year's recipient is Eric Mills. Technology Award for Academic Excellence goes to Laura DeLuzio. The Medici Award. In the tradition of the Renaissance, artists were builders. It is in that spirit that the Medici Award is made to the graduating students whose growth has been characterized not only by aesthetic sensibility, but by curiosity, energy, and the cooperative spirit of the studio. In awarding a tool that can be used to earn a living and to build a dream, the Greenfield Community College Art Department are proud to make the presentation to four students who will know how to use it, and this includes a hammer. So here we go. Christina McComb, Wesley Talbot, Julianne Jones, and Jessica Glover. Criminal Justice Award, which recognizes outstanding achievement in this field, criminal justice. This year's recipient is Daniel Larvey. Education Award for Excellence in the Care and Education of Young Children this year goes to Patricia Goodwin. Recognize the International Student Scholastic Achievement Award winner. This award is given to students who have risen above the language and cultural differences to join the college community and to complete their programs of study successfully. This year's award is presented to Sang Shu Yu from Taiwan. Recognize the efforts of academic award winners who were not able to participate in commencement this year. Please hold your applause until I've read the entire list of three. Thank you. The award for excellence in nursing this year goes to Daniel Larrigy, who's not here. The award for academic excellence in nursing this year goes to Kelly Savitri, who also was unable to come and to be here. And the award for excellence in accounting goes to Randy Andrews. Let's applaud them. recognition of individuals, the college has this opportunity to honor the achievement of three groups of graduating students. First, we start with the peer tutoring program, which would like to honor current and former tutors and lab assistants who are participating in commencement. They have been a behind-the-scenes part of the success of many of the students sitting here. As I say the name of these individual students, please rise and remain standing until all of your names have been read. We will honor you at your seats. Matthew Buda, Megan Ariel Berglowitz, Ellie Cappy Goldfarb, Gabrielle Marie Connell, please stay standing, Kia Crowley, Michael Robert Fain, Nellie Gonzalez-Slazoska, Jessica Lynn Hicks, Madeline Laporte, Daniel Larrigy, Trevor Paul LeDoit, Scott McAllister, and Guinevere Arthur Van Horn. Bravo, and thank you to each one of those for their contributions and success today. The second group we recognize is Phi Theta Kappa. They are students noted with an asterisk in your program, as well as students who may be wearing gold tassels and stoles to represent their membership in Phi Theta Kappa, which is the Community College National Honor Society. Woo! So, will all members of Phi Theta Kappa please rise in place? I'm going to read your name so that we may applaud your academic accomplishments. This is an honor that comes through academic success indeed. So we are ready now. Barbara Adams, Grace Aiken, April Albright, Camlin Allen, Wayne Thomas Allen, Michael Brusco, Nicole Bruel, William David Burton, Zoe Clark, Amy Marie Cullen, Loon Young Teresa Huang, Kendra Evan Kane, Emily Levine, Daniel L.E. LeClaire, Taylor Lindell, Carlos A. Massa, Kristen Mattson, Cassidy Menard, Mary Elizabeth Mathot, Martha Anderson Miller, Molly Marie Monahan, Daniel Pereira, Alexandra Redden, Alicia Lauren Richter, Allison M. Stacy, Emily E. Steiner, Jennifer K. Tufano, are you up here? Oliver Ulig, Alyssa Valbona, Guinevere Arthur Van Horn, Rebecca Wolf, Catherine A. Woods, and Chad E. Wright. We'll also get to recognize honor students when we read names. The third group that we honor today are our veterans. In recognition of their service in the United States Armed Forces, students who have served or are currently serving our country, please stand. That they stay standing and be joined by anyone in the audience who has also served in our armed services. All please stand. addition to recognizing the academic achievements of our graduates, the college also recognizes the co-curricular efforts and achievements of select graduates and staff with two separate significant awards. The first is the Walter M. Taylor Award. It's named for the very first president of the college, is presented to a member of the faculty, staff, or administration who has given outstanding leadership in the development of co-curricular activities. The person being given this award at this year has been a major part of co-curricular programming at GCC for many years. She's put together countless programs herself, but more importantly, has also encouraged the entire campus to think about co-curricular programs as an integral part of teaching and learning for all. She's worked with faculty and staff to increase the capacity for anyone on campus to put on their own educational programming, and regularly collaborates with faculty to provide programming directly related and supportive of classroom work. For the past year and a half, she single-handedly worked on the Diversity Program Subcommittee, providing quality diversity programming with very limited resources. It's time to honor all of her contributions to co-curricular life here at GCC and also her civic learning collaboration with our community agencies. It's my deep pleasure to present this year's Taylor Award to Judy Raper. Give the Charles Green Award, which is presented to a graduating student for leadership in co-curricular activities and the development of our college. The award is named for the first assistant to the president of Greenfield Community College. We are honored to recognize a GCC student for their distinct leadership in co-curricular activities. This year's recipient of the Charles Green Award is the student representative to the Board of Trustees, Chad E. Wright. Individually, these students embody the GCC mission and the vision of strengthening our community one person at a time in a small, supportive community of learners with diverse backgrounds and stories and experiences. Thank you all for your help in the recognition of these achievements. One more round for them and all of our students, please.
Emeritus status is granted upon retirement to those members of the faculty who have distinguished themselves in and out of the classroom over the course of their career. It is voted on by their peers and then conferred by the Board of Trustees of GCC. I would like to call on Dean Mary Ellen Feitenkevich to introduce our first recipient, Professor Brian Adams. Dean Feitenkevich.
Thank you. Since they let me speak, I'd just like to say congratulations to all the graduates first. But I'm here really to give an award to a colleague and a friend, and I'd like to just take a moment to read a little bit about what his colleagues wrote about him. It says, with abundance, confidence, and joy, this letter is written in full support of the granting status a Professor Emeritus to Brian Adams. Professor, please. Brian is Professor of Environmental Science. His colleagues expressed the sentiment of the science staff and faculty when they described Brian as the soul of the department. He's a self-professed sufferer of OCD, not the OCD you're thinking of. It's called obsessional climate disorder. If you know that Brian has most recently written a published novel called Love in the Time of Climate Change, incidentally, it's set at a community college, someplace in a valley that's similar to this valley. It's a very interesting read. You should try it. No faculty member has had more impact on the environmental-related curriculum, the infrastructure, the programs, and the energy footprint of the college than Brian Adams. Amazingly, all of Brian's incredibly effective advocacy has been done with his infectious and irrelevant good humor. Brian laughs at himself, laughs at the absurdities around him, and laughs when most of us would cry. And by getting the college to laugh with him, he affects real and lasting change. Let me give you a few examples of what Brian has done for us here at GCC campus. Look to the north of the east building and notice the PV panels there. That's with the help of Brian's influence. Look at the south end of the campus as you walk up from the staff parking lot and note the near net zero energy greenhouse. Note as you walk to the front of the campus, you'll see the whale skull. That also was Brian's influence. Walk around the campus with the help, and notice the blue recycling containers. Those are from help of Brian's influence. We are better by Brian's passion. He has served us in so many ways. Scores of students under Brian's directions experienced the world of scientific research and while earning money to support their education through a fish project. Brian has been a group leader in so many ways, including the Pioneer Valley Institute and a climate change coordinator as well. Brian has earned a Professional Staff Merit Award in 2002, and he was granted tenure in 2005. Brian has consistently earned rave reviews from his deans and, more importantly, from you students. What do his students say about Brian? Well, many of you may have known something called Rate My Professor. Some of you may have been on it. They rate him as one of the best professors at GCC. Funny, engaging, knowledgeable, and has a very contagious passion about science and the natural world. One of my favorite professors ever, and I wasn't even interested in environmental science until I studied with Professor Brian Adams. Most famously, Brian is known for the first class of his environmental science course by reading his favorite piece of literature. Does anybody know what that is? Yes, The Lorax by Dr. Zeus. So to his students, as Dr. Zeus explains, "By now," says the onceler, "now that you're here, the world of the Lorax seems perfectly clear. Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better. It's not. No person has cared more about GCC and its place in the natural world than Brian Adams. And because Brian has cared a whole awful lot, so much has gotten better. It's what Brian Adams wrought." Thank you.
I would like to now call Dean Kathy Brenos up to the podium, who will introduce Professor Kate Finnegan as our second recipient. Dean Brenos.
Good.
Good afternoon. You've already heard a bit about and from Professor Finnegan. It's my pleasure to put the icing on the cake today. The term emerita, as Dr. Pura shared, remains a mark of distinguished service awarded to few faculty members on retirement who exemplify the values of GCC's mission and vision over the course of their careers. You may have been able to tell so far today that Professor Finnegan is not shy. She has unapologetic passion for the people that she cares most about in this world, her students, and the little people whom her students will go out and mentor, nurture, cherish, and help to develop as they go along. Professor Finnegan has been a beacon of grace, scholarship, and student-centric leadership at Greenfield Community College since she joined the faculty in 1980. Her leadership has helped to establish GCC as a model of quality programming in early childhood education throughout the state of Massachusetts, where her voice is a well-respected and sought-after standard of excellence. Within the college, Professor Finnegan is a nudge. She advocates for students with a powerful, authentic, and passionate voice, and her integrity and extremely high standard for teaching have served as an inspiration for colleagues. She has contributed her wise voice and depth of expertise to numerous initiatives over the decades, raising the standard in early childhood education so that GCC is one of few community colleges in the state to have NIAC accreditation, and to ensure that leadership is a part of the professional curriculum and standard for early childhood educators, a much needed innovation in the field. In addition, her collaboration with our area's local Head Start has been transformational in helping the agency to meet the needs of low-income families and their young children in this area. Perhaps the embodiment of Professor Finnegan's legacy is best captured in the soon-to-be-built Child Care Center at GCC, which will serve as a testament to the respect this college gives you, our students, and the many responsibilities you carry as parents. Surely the sight of the little people growing in environments exquisitely designed to enhance their development will remind all of us of Professor Finnegan's passion for education, her high standards for excellence, and the song in her step, which lifts all who teach and learn alongside her. Congratulations, Catherine Finnegan, Professor Emerita.
Robert Yacoubian began working at GCC in 1971 and retired in 1998. The positions that Rob held during each of those 27 years were focused on students and their success. Very few who have worked at GCC have done more to lift our students' aspirations or help students achieve their dreams. Over the span of his career, Rob's contributions have been significant and sustainable. And his work will have an enduring impact on the quality of the college. In honor of his life's work, GCC established the Robert Mugar Yacoubian Distinguished Service Award. Greenfield Community College will make this award only on occasion to retiring individuals who have distinguished themselves through the value and degree of service to the college community. Award recipients will have consistently demonstrated exceptional dedication to the advancement of the mission, to the vision, and to the principles of the college. I am pleased to award the Robert Mugar Yacoubian Distinguished Service Award to Judy Green Corvey and Tim Shippey. Judy Green Corvey's career at GCC has spanned 27 years as a teacher and a leader. Judy began as coordinator counselor for a vocational education programs for emerging careers, and later assumed responsibilities as program coordinator of recreation and leisure. Judy's skills in creating positive collaborations, attending to strategic priorities while building consensus, bringing programs and projects to successful conclusions, all led to the launch of her career in administration. Judy's leadership has extended from assessment and our accreditation work internally to statewide initiatives such as PARC and AMCOA. Through patient and individualized mentorship, Judy has inspired excellence in academic assessment. She is deeply appreciated for her good humor and flexibility, and is described by colleagues as a people person, creative and sensitive to the nuanced needs of various groups and individuals. Faculty and staff have universally enjoyed working with Judy and have respected her leadership throughout her career. On behalf of the students, faculty, and staff of GCC, I am pleased to award the Robert Mugar Yacoubian Distinguished Service Award to Judy Green Corvet. Judy? When you look up the words hard work, commitment, wisdom, and professionalism, you see a picture of Tim Shippey, GCC's head of grounds. When you drive onto College Drive and into GCC, you will see a reflection of Tim in our fields as well. Who here today cannot speak to the way in which that drive is the most perfect roadway into education? Who has not felt its transformative powers? Who has not wondered how the heck all that snow had been removed so fast? To quote his supervisor, Jeff Marks, it is an honor to work with professionals of Tim's high caliber and whose hard work and dedication produce superb results. He has been a dedicated professional committed to creating the very best environment for students, faculty, staff, in our community every day for over 40 years. Tim managed not only our physical space, but as a local AFSCME leader, he helped to ensure a good working environment for all. Oh, by the way, the folks at the Green River Festival will miss Tim as much as we will. So on behalf of the students, faculty, and staff of GCC, I am pleased to award the Robert Mugar Yacoubian Distinguished Service Award to Tim Shippey. It is also now my honor to ask Board Chairman Robbie Cohn to come to the podium for a very special moment that I know you've been waiting for. I can't think of anybody more passionate in his support for GCC. I can't think of anybody that has been around the college from its inception to this moment with more commitment. And from the perspective as a student himself, an alum, from the perspective as a parent of an alum, from the perspective of the husband of an alum, Robbie Cohn speaks every day with great passion about all of you and all of what happens here at GCC. Please welcome Board Chairman Robbie Cohn.
Good afternoon. I've been sitting here thinking, what am I going to say after listening to everybody speak? This is a proud moment for all of you. I started my career at this college 45 years ago. We were in a factory on Arch Street that if you breathed in the air long enough, you probably would have gotten sick. But here you've got this beautiful campus. What I learned at GCC, it wasn't about the physical structure. It was about the teachers and the faculty and the staff, the people that wanted to help you succeed. And I can relate to every one of you. I came to GCC as a loser. I'm not saying you're a loser. I'm saying I was a loser. But you know, I came out, I wasn't quite a winner, but I was on the right track. And it's because of the help and the nurturing I got here. It wasn't from anything else. It was also from my own work. I realized I was sort of at a dead end. And I hope you never can relate to that. But I also want you to know that you've got a great future. You've got a lot of challenges. The world evolves, and you're going to evolve with it. The great experience you had yesterday will never happen again. Other similar great experiences will come. You will cherish them. You will love them. You're going to leave GCC today, and you might forget about it for a while. I didn't think about it for a few years. I went on to college. I came back and started working. And then I started to realize, as I considered my own small success, why that was. And it was because of the confidence instilled in me by the teachers and the faculty and staff here at GCC. You've had a great time here, you've had challenges, but you're going to have more challenges because everything evolves. What you should be leaving this campus with today is instilled confidence. You got through the programs here. You can get through anything you want. The only thing that's going to hold you back is yourself. And rest assured, there's nobody here in this room or under this tent that thinks you can hold yourself back. So I want to thank you for being here today. I want to thank you for being students at GCC. I want to thank the college. I want to thank the foundation who has supported all of us through good times and bad. They're there every year. Everybody loves this college. Congratulations to all of you, and thank you. I've never written a speech. I've never read one. But now, because I am the board chair, I have to read a statement to confer your degrees, because none of you are college graduates or community college graduates yet, but you will be momentarily. By the authority vested in me by the Massachusetts Department of Higher Education, under Chapter 15A, Sections 8 and 22 of the General Laws of the Commonwealth, I, Robert S. Cohn, chair of the Board of Trustees of Greenfield Community College, am honored to award the Associates in Arts and Associates in Science degrees and certificates to those candidates who, in the judgment of the college, have successfully met the requirements for graduation. I speak on behalf of all of our trustees. We are proud of all of you. Thank you.
Bree Auburn. Santana Irene Allers. Ashley Irene Allen. Cameron Q. Allen, with honors. Wayne Thomas Allen, also with honors. Bradley Belleville. And now our Bradley Belleville will present the diploma to his daughter, Candace. So please celebrate Candace.
Cassandra Hayes.
support Hayes.
Thank you.
Alicia Prevost. Alicia Lauren Richter with honors. Luisa Rurka. Cassandra L. Seacard with honors. With honors and also with an Associate in Science in Art and Fine Art. Kevin Strafty. Bowie L. Thornton, graduating with honors.
Matthew Buddha with honors.
Keisha A. Hill. Christopher J. Howe. Joseph E. Curlin Smith. We switch now to Associate in Science, Computer Information Systems, and we recognize first Christine Abercrombie, also with a certificate in management. Next, we have Amberlyn Beausoleil with a certificate in management as well as her associate's degree.
Yeah.
Joshua A. Carnes, graduating with honors. Edward Deke, graduating with honors. Todd Goulston, who's also graduating with an Associate in Arts in Liberal Arts. Warren Thomas Kawash, graduating with honors. Trevor Paul Ledoit, graduating with honors. Andrew J. Steiner. Those graduating with an Associate in Science in Fire Science Technology. I asked Peter Rosnick to come forward, a college former dean, adjunct director of SAGE. The list of his accomplishments and contributions could go on. I asked him to join me on stage to present a diploma to his son, Jesse Sobek Rosnick. Rana. Beatrice Maria Shelke. Dawn Margot Ann St. Lucer. Rebecca Wolf is here with honors and an Associate of Arts in Liberal Arts as well as her nursing degree. We now move on to recognize a set of students who have earned certificates, and you will see the numbers of these students increase with each year. We recognize first those with a certificate in computer information systems, General Office Administration. And we start with Corinne J. Peters. We move on to recognize Sylvia Wilson. We move now to certificates in management. And our first one is Laura DeLuzio. I'm getting help with this one since I have not done exactly right to this one.
Mark Levievich Pribyshev.
Certificates in medical assisting. We have a group of these students. Joanne Holloway. Amber Hubbard. Sarah Kimball. Alicia O'Leary. Caitlin B. Stone. Amber L. Stowes. And Jennifer A. Sullivan.
did it! To the Phi Theta Kappa, to all of the peer tutors, to all of the award winners, and to all the graduates, congratulations! A line that is as much a celebration of what has happened to this point, but more about the steps you're about to take. Congratulations to you all, and there's a reception up in the dining commons. Congratulations to the whole class of 2015!